Although Morning Joe was pretty friendly toward Trump and his campaign while he was running, after he got elected, they've been more critical, and I think that that's been pretty evident. Now, recently, Morning Joe decided to talk about how Donald Trump had fake Time magazine covers of himself in as many as 5 of his golf courses throughout the world. And, you know, they poked a little fun at him. In fact, take a look at what Mika Brzezinski had to say.
Nothing makes a man feel better than making a fake cover of a magazine about himself, lying every day and destroying the country.
Okay.
It's a good feeling.
Well, enough about me. But what were you,
are your hands in that photo?
Well, he's covering his hands here because they're teensy.
The other crazy thing about that.
Now,
she really does go after him. I hadn't seen that piece of tape. She really goes after him.
Now, right now, there is speculation as to whether or not that particular segment set Trump off on a little bit of a Twitter tiff. He goes on Twitter and he starts attacking Joe Scarborough and Mika Brzezinski. And he says something that has led to a little bit of backlash, even from Republicans. So let me read you those tweets. He says, he's such a child. I heard poorly rated Morning Joe speaks badly of me. Don't watch anymore. Yes, you do. Then how come low IQ crazy Mika along with psycho Joe came to Mar-a-Lago 3 nights in a row around New Year's Eve and insisted on joining me? She was bleeding badly from a facelift. I said no. So Trump seems to have some weird obsession with women and blood, because remember he attacked Megyn Kelly for asking him a mildly difficult question during a debate and said, oh, she's bleeding from her whatever he said. And so that was, you know, his latest attack against Mika, talking about, you know, her looks and I don't know, you guys take it. I'm just so tired of the shit.
Well, you know, the first thing I thought of when I read it was that Melania Trump's big cause is cyberbullying.
Yeah. It's amazing, right?
And this, you know, buffoon lying next to her in bed is doing this.
To be fair, I doubt they're dying.
I doubt they're lying in the same bed. But that's, you know,
just in general.
Be that as it may.
Painting a picture of.
I see. You meant it metaphorically.
Familial bliss.
Yeah. Right? Okay.
Playing with their dogs and goldfish, but yeah, I mean, and then thinking just how disgusting this is, right?
Right.
And how beneath the office, and also how I knew what Republican senators were going to say, like, oh, this is terrible, and that would be it.
No, this is terrible, but I still support it.
Right, right.
Which is exactly the kind of response we got from Republicans.
In some cases, it went farther. And I know, Anna, you're going to have a couple of those, but the general acceptance that this is the way this guy conducts business is what is so off-putting.
But you know, it is off-putting for us because we don't expect the leader of this country to be a child. We expect him to act a certain way and set an example and be a leader, and he is the antithesis of that.
But here's something, because we also expect that our senators and our members
of Congress are
going to stand up to
this. At some point.
The voters who he appealed to, for whatever reason, across whatever spectrum he was able to pull them. And I know that you're in the middle of a thought, but I have to say that you expect more. You don't expect more from this guy because that's what he was sent there for. But you expect more for the people who are a buffer between those voters and this president and us to stand up to this, and they don't do it enough.
Well, I think everything, I mean, if you put this entire situation in context, starting from, you know, the campaign to the election to where we are today, all of this has been incredibly disappointing, because I don't think that this is just a reflection of Trump. I think it's a reflection of the American people. I think it's a reflection of our lawmakers. And it's incredibly disappointing when you think about the fact that, you know, there are literally children that have handle situations more maturely than our lawmakers do. And there are children who probably understand how wrong it is for Trump to say these types of things about anyone. You know, it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. This type of rhetoric should not be acceptable. But the point that I was trying to make was that, look, this is not the kind of story that his base cares about. His base knows what kind of person he is. I mean, he gets caught on tape talking about grabbing women by the genitals. He, you know, refers to women as pigs. He, you know, talks about Megyn Kelly menstruating and acts as if that is like the worst thing, the most embarrassing thing for a woman. I mean, he has a history of saying incredibly despicable things to women time and time again. If anything, there are members of his base that love this kind of stuff. And they think that he's a strong person because he continuously insults people without caring about the ramifications. But you know, the only people who are really concerned and really put off by this are people who aren't going to vote for him anyway. And so again, this whole situation is so incredibly disappointing and discouraging because I think it says a lot about where we are as a society, right? I think people pretended like they were civil, but no, we're not civil. We're freaking animals and we treat each other like crap. And I don't care where you are in your political ideology, we all need to take a step back and really rethink the way that we're communicating with one another. This is disgusting. Now let's hear from
just to say that was great. I mean, really, that is it. Because I love that you took it from the specific to the general. Mm-hmm. And then I'll stop. But Twitter, oddly, has fed what Anna's talking about.
Yeah, so here, absolutely.
His
not oddly,
Twitter
definitely.
Comments have ended up in this machine of hate and this machine of division. And so you really see it played out, the cyberbullying, you see it played out every day in so many tweets across the board. So in a way, Donald Trump is feeding that machine. And Twitter is just a symptom of what Anna's talking about, which is that the society has become so divisive in its dialogue that nothing is too personal and nothing's too rude.
That, yeah, absolutely. And by the way, Mika did have a response to it. She tweeted, she didn't tweet to him, but she tweeted that box of Cheerios made for
that?
Little hands.
I saw it earlier, but I love seeing it.
Which is pretty funny. And so I bring that up only because nothing gets under his skin more than insults about his hands. And that's another thing, like I want a president who doesn't have such thin skin, man. Like he gets insulted so easily and he gets up in arms and he loses his temper and he goes on Twitter and he's like, oh, how dare you talk about the size of my hands? I have gigantic hands. Anyway.
Well, this is a guy who held a cabinet meeting specifically to be dedicated to at least the first 5 minutes of it, complimenting him on the job he's doing, right? And how grateful you are to be around him. I mean, he needs not only not to be insulted, but he needs people ingratiating themselves to him constantly.
And Ben Sasse, the Republican who has just been at his throat since day one. You know, to his credit, he's probably the most consistent Republican against Trump.
He's got
tweeted,
some sass. Yeah.
Please just stop. This isn't normal, and it's beneath the dignity of your office, which clearly it is. And it would be great if more people with jobs that like Ben Sasse's said the same thing.
So some Republicans did come out and say that they were not in favor of the inappropriate language that Trump is using on social media. However, they still support him. One of those lawmakers is, of course, Paul Ryan. Let's hear from him.
You have been critical of the president when he has, you know, made some comments that you have felt are out of line. Are these comments out of line?
Are you talking about this morning's tweet? Yeah, I just saw it a little bit ago. Obviously, I don't see that as an appropriate comment. I think, look, what we're trying to do around here is improve the tone and the civility of the debate. And this obviously doesn't help do that.
I mean, Michael, look, I loathe Paul Ryan, I must offer that disclaimer. But when you were just saying, you know, we need more of what politicians stop short of saying anything. I don't know what the guy could, if I'm Paul Ryan, I mean, even as Mark Thompson as Paul Ryan, I think I say probably the same thing. If my political future is wedded to that guy.
Yeah, I don't know. I think if you're Tip O'Neill, or you're Jim Wright, you say the president's got to stop doing this, right?
You say that publicly to the press?
You say it publicly. Tip O'Neill would have said that publicly to the press.
I just think politically you don't gain anything. This guy's not going to change.
Politically,
you can't change him.
But you're the Speaker of the House, right? I mean, listen, it's not just ideal pie in the sky stuff. This is basic politics. I think you do get somewhere with it. This is a guy who was belittled by Donald Trump himself, Paul Ryan. And yes, they are talking about civility. They are talking about—
These guys are a bunch of spineless a-holes.
No. Their colleague, a member of his leadership team was shot and almost killed on a baseball field. They're talking about civility. This is happening in the middle of discourses about civility.
Yes.
So they have to be more critical of it than they otherwise would be.
That's
especially
absolutely
with that
right.
Background.
Yeah, and look, I criticize, you know, the rhetoric that's being used on both sides, although I would argue that, you know, the violent rhetoric is, you know, more common on the right. But look, It's just incredible because that shooting happened. It was tragic and disgusting, and it made me take a step back and think about my own rhetoric, and I want to make sure that I do my job responsibly. And that kind of, you know, thought process seems to only happen on the left. It's the same standard that should be, you know, expected from the right as well. So you can't be using rhetoric that, you know, demonizes people just because they insulted the size of your hands. You know, you should stand up, be a leader. I think Paul Ryan, here's an opportunity to be a leader and do more than just say like, oh yeah, that was inappropriate, I'm not in favor of it, but I still support the president. Okay, let's move on, let's talk about something else.
Right,
but because that's what we get from them time and time again.
Of course, and I think that's what we'll get from them till the end of time, the end of Trump time. But I think when you're called upon by your party, which is the way they see themselves, to a higher goal, sort of an ends justifies the means kind of approach to politics, there's just no percentage in taking your criticism of the president any further. You know he's not going to change. Paul Ryan knows that whatever he says is not going to change anything.
But it doesn't matter. They have to have some balls about this. They have to be able, you're not going to change Donald Trump. That's fine. But change the way that you're perceived and bind together to, you know, stop being like as they have been, bind together and go at the president, not because you're going to change him, but because you're going to change the way you are perceived.
Yes, of course I agree, but I would say you're asking from these guys who've demonstrated clearly that they're not capable of that move. I mean, they are sleeping with the serpent and they're okay with it. You're asking them to do something that they are just incapable of doing.
What do you get for Young Turks membership? It's a mystery. Only one way to find out. TYTnetwork.com/join.
Rude.
That, yeah, absolutely. By the way, Mika did have a response to it. She tweeted, she didn't tweet to him, but she tweeted that box of Cheerios made for little hands.
I saw it earlier, but I love seeing it.
Which is pretty funny. And so I bring that up only because nothing gets under his skin more than insults about his hands. And that's another thing, like, I want a president who doesn't have such thin skin, man. Like, he gets insulted so easily and he gets up in arms and he loses his temper and he goes on Twitter and he's like, oh, how dare you talk about the size of my hands? I have gigantic hands. Anyway.
Well, this is a guy who held a cabinet meeting specifically to be dedicated to at least the first 5 minutes of it, complimenting him on the job he's doing, right? And how grateful you are to be around him. I mean, he needs not only not to be insulted, but he needs people ingratiating themselves to him constantly.
And Ben Sasse, the Republican who has just been at his throat since day one, you know, to his credit, he's probably the most consistent Republican against Trump.
He's got
tweeted,
some sass, yeah.
Please just stop. This isn't normal and it's beneath the dignity of your office, which clearly it is. And it would be great if more people with jobs that like Ben Sasse's said the same thing.
So some Republicans did come out and say that they were not in favor of the inappropriate language that Trump is using on social media. However, they still support him. One of those lawmakers is, of course, Paul Ryan. Let's hear from him.
You have been critical of the president when he has, you know, made some comments that you have felt are out of line.
Country to be a child, we expect him to act a certain way and set an example and be a leader, and he is the antithesis of that.
But here's something, because we also expect that our senators and our members
of Congress are
going to stand up to
that. At some point.
The voters who he appealed to, for whatever reason, across whatever spectrum he was able to pull them. And I know that you're in the middle of a thought, but I have to say that you expect more. You don't expect more from this guy because that's what he was sent there for. But you expect more for the people who are a buffer between those voters and this president and us to stand up to this, and they don't do it enough.
Well, I think everything, I mean, if you put this entire situation in context, starting from, you know, the campaign to the election to where we are today, all of this has been incredibly disappointing because I don't think that this is just a reflection of Trump. I think it's a reflection of the American people. I think it's a reflection of our lawmakers. And it's incredibly disappointing when you think about the fact that, you know, there are literally children that have handle situations more maturely than our lawmakers do. And there are children who probably understand how wrong it is for Trump to say these types of things about anyone. You know, it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman, this type of rhetoric should not be acceptable. But the point that I was trying to make was that, Look, this is not the kind of story that his base cares about. His base knows what kind of person he is. I mean, he gets caught on tape talking about grabbing women by the genitals. He, you know, refers to women as pigs. He, you know, So Trump seems to have some weird obsession with women and blood, because remember, he attacked Megyn Kelly for asking him a mildly difficult question during a debate and said, oh, she's bleeding from her whatever he said. And so that was, you know, his latest attack against Mika, talking about, you know, her looks and I don't know, you guys take it. I'm just so tired of the shit.
Well, you know, the first thing I thought of when I read it was that Melania Trump's big cause is cyberbullying.
Yeah. It's amazing, yeah, right?
And this, you know, buffoon lying next to her in bed is doing this.
To be fair, I doubt they're dying.
I doubt they're lying in the same bed. But that's, you know,
just in general.
Be that as it may.
Painting a picture of.
I see. You meant it metaphorically.
Familial bliss.
Yeah. Right? Okay. Yeah.
Playing with their dogs and goldfish. But yeah, I mean, and then thinking just how disgusting this is, right?
Right.
And how beneath the office, and also how I knew what Republican senators were going to say, like, oh, this is terrible, and that would be it.
No, I'm this is terrible, but I still support it,
right?
Which is exactly the kind of response we got from Republicans.
In some cases, it went farther. And I know, Anna, you're going to have a couple of those, but the general acceptance that this is the way this guy conducts business is what is so off-putting.
But you know, it is off-putting for us because we don't expect the leader of this. Although Morning Joe was pretty friendly toward Trump and his campaign while he was running, after he got elected, they've been more critical, and I think that that's been pretty evident. Now, recently, Morning Joe decided to talk about how Donald Trump had fake Time magazine covers of himself in as many as 5 of his golf courses throughout the world. And, you know, they poked a little fun at him. In fact, take a look at what Mika Brzezinski had to say.
Nothing makes a man feel better than making a fake cover of a magazine about himself, lying every day and destroying the country.
Okay.
It's a good feel.
Well, enough about me. But where
are your hands in that photo?
Well, he's covering his hands here because they're teensy.
The other crazy thing about that.
Now,
she really does go after him. I hadn't seen that piece of tape. She really goes after him.
Now, right now, there is speculation as to whether or not that particular segment set Trump off on a little bit of a Twitter tiff. He goes on Twitter and he starts attacking Joe Scarborough and Mika Brzezinski. And he says something that has led to a little bit of backlash, even from Republicans. So let me read you those tweets. He says, I heard, he's such a child. I heard poorly rated Morning Joe speaks badly of me. Don't watch anymore. Yes, you do. Then how come low IQ crazy Mika along with psycho Joe came to Mar-a-Lago 3 nights in a row around New Year's Eve and insisted on joining me? She was bleeding badly from a facelift. I said no. Talks about Megyn Kelly menstruating and acts as if that is like the worst thing, the most embarrassing thing for a woman. I mean, he has a history of saying incredibly despicable things to women time and time again. If anything, there are members of his base that love this kind of stuff. And they think that he's a strong person because he continuously insults people without caring about the ramifications. But, you know, the only people who are really concerned and really put off by this are people who aren't going to vote for him anyway. And so, again, this whole situation is so incredibly disappointing and discouraging because I think it says a lot about where we are as a society, right? I think people pretended like they were civil, but no, we're not civil. We're freaking animals and we treat each other like crap. And I don't care where you are in your political ideology. We all need to take a step back and really rethink the way that we're communicating with one another. This is disgusting. Now, let's hear from
just to say that was great. I mean, really, that is it, because I love that you took it from the specific to the general. Mm-hmm. And then I'll stop. But Twitter oddly has fed what Anna's talking about.
Yeah, so here, absolutely.
His
not oddly,
Twitter
definitely.
Comments have ended up in this machine of hate and this machine of division. And so you really see it played out, the cyberbullying, you see it played out every day in so many tweets across the board. So in a way, Donald Trump is feeding that
machine. And Twitter is just a symptom of what Anna's talking about, which is that the society has become so divisive in its dialogue that nothing is too personal and nothing is too